line coming out through the back of it. But do you know what? We're all in this together. And with Rishi Sunak saying that we are now officially in recession, this is going to be tough for people. It's that, you know, it might hit, it might be bad, it might, and now it really is here. So working in an environment which is effectively a turnaround and recovery one for a whole economy, your business needs that additional help and support. It just does.
Absolutely. Hi, Gunnar. How are you doing?
Hello. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you fine. How are you today?
I'm good. Cold, as you said.
It is a bit cold, isn't it?
Mind you, it's going to be, what did they say? It was on, I think the forecast is Tuesday or Wednesday. Supposedly it should be 24 degrees. So I'm looking forward to that.
Oh, that'll be nice. Yeah, I welcome that. I went for a run this morning, Gunnar, but my knee just still feels a bit tight this morning. I've got to be honest.
Yeah, I saw that. I saw your update. That's good.
Yeah, it was first one for a few weeks. I think I needed to get out, and it was nice. But actually, you know, it doesn't feel too bad, the old knee.
Hey, you're younger than me. Come on.
Oh. Nice card to pull, absolutely.
there's only a few years in us, surely, Gunnar. Only a few years. I think we've got some more people joining, which is great.
Can you just put the slides down then? We'll start from the beginning.
Yes, I will.
Okay.
Let's go from the start from the top. Let me just double check. Yes, that's the one.
This is great. This will be Groundhog Day for Gunnar and I and yourself. But this is, you know, something that hopefully will help the guys on the call to really have a different kind of experience, because I've done a fair few of these with different recruiters now. And you come away from it and you actually think, well, there's been lots of talking, but I've got nothing to take away from it. And this is different because it is actually really practical of, do you know what? This is how we assess in the business, and Gunnar has the playbook for how we then plug that back in. So it really dovetails very well.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Hiya, Tim.
Hi there. Hi, I'm plugged in now.
Good. Hi, man.
Hi, nice to meet you all.
Nice to meet you, Tim. I think we've got Jonathan on the call, Jonathan Mortlock as well.
Okay, great.
Hi, Jonathan, you okay?
Yes, thank you, yourselves.
Yeah, very good, thanks. Very good. I think we'll start. I was expecting a few more people to come on the call, but I've had quite a few emails this morning saying that people are have other priorities. We've just got Paul joining the call now. I think we might wait a few more minutes. But while we're on, I'll just kind of set the scene a little bit to Tim and Jonathan, who weren't with us last week, and Paul as well. Thank you for joining us. So we try to keep the this very, very informal and relaxed. There'll be some slides from Tracy. We shared some slides from Gunnar last week. Gunnar Menzel is the CITO or CTIO. Gunnar, have I got that right?
Either way, it's fine. CTIO, yes.
CTIO for Capgemini. And if you want those slides from last week's session, I'll happily email them to you. We've just got another person joining. So I'm just going to leave this for just a minute or so extra. Hi, Susie. Welcome.
Hi, Sam.
Thanks for joining us. I think we might have a contractor joining us who is currently working for Microsoft at the moment in quite a senior product role, very cloud orientated. So I thought that might be interesting based on your TechnoVision chat last week, and cloud being one of those four key technologies that you feel that people should be paying attention to, obviously. Now, he's not joined us yet, but I think he will do. So I'm going to kick off with Tracy Keeling. Tracy is our chair for the day. Tracy has 20 years' experience in IT and tech. And from a business continuity point of view, she helped us to publish a white paper recently on business continuity. And it was sadly driven by COVID, but it was really, really useful, really, really interesting. She spent 11 years working for Hewlett Packard and proudly has only spent 3 weeks on the bench at Hewlett Packard there. So I'll hand over to Tracy. Atul is just joining us. Hi, Atul. I think he's just connecting to his audio. Atul is currently contracting at Microsoft at the moment and in a product lead product role. So we'll get some feedback from Atul. The way that we're going to play this is if everyone can mute themselves just for now. Last week, I think we had somebody who didn't mute themselves, and I think their phone was in their pocket, and we had some really bad feedback. So if everyone can mute themselves for now, we're going to hear from Tracy, and then we're going to put it out to the attendees with some questions and answers. I've got my dog with me today, and nobody noticed last week, but we had a delivery, and my dog's lovely. He's a Cocker Spaniel, but he's got some anxiety issues. So if the doorbell goes, he goes ballistic, and hopefully I'll mute myself in time. But if you do hear a dog going mad, that's my my dog, Duke. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Tracy, and she's going to be talking about the agenda. We're going to do a recap on last week, and then we're going to go through some slides from Tracy. So thank you, Tracy. Over to you.
Okay, brilliant. Thanks, Sam. So last week we actually talked about where do we start as a business. Everybody is being impacted in some way, shape or form, and it's a minefield. Every single day the briefing comes out, we're getting information drip fed, different changes, different things. And 3 days ago Rishi Sunak came out with, we're now officially in recession. So anything is, you know, not going to improve anytime soon. We're going to have to seriously look at business and how we take things forward on the basis that the entire economy is going to be in a recession for at least the next year. If you study the economics and we look at the way things are going at the moment, this is the environment that we're currently in. So business impact, for anybody that's not been on the call, where do you start? How do you navigate through this? How do boards make decisions based on where we are and start to find a way through in order to get the very best performance and capability out of the existing organization that you're working with? So effectively, thank you, Sam, for doing these slides for me. Four pillars for any business: your people, process, customer, and technology are absolutely critical. It's understanding how that is now having to flex and what the impacts are on each and every area. So the second wave now, you know, potentially we're seeing it across China, they're getting more in, some of the figures across other parts of the world. We're now starting to see that although we thought that it had cleared with the COVID problem, we're now getting other impacts. There's actually an additional COVID offshoot for this, which is affecting children in a different way. It's affecting their kidneys and things. So we've got lots of different dynamics. We've got the political, the social, the technical. We've got the cultural side. We've got schools. We've got Boris Johnson, who opens his mouth and gives us a different roadmap every day that we then have to start to mould around. And we need to understand these things. But we, again, have the unknown unknown. So if anybody's done their risk management, my favourite is the ABCD model, but I've used 5 or 6 from different organisations. You have to plan for what might not be known and do some what-if scenarios. If this happens, could we cope? Are any of these potentially going to be absolutely life-changing and are going to cripple us? So it's starting to put some thought in around those once we've done this next phase. So next slide, Sam. So there's lots of things that we can do, and the classic consulting model is usually we'll come in, we'll do you a 12-week piece of work, we'll do a full assessment, you'll get a lovely big Word document at the end of it. There'll be a bit of a groan because it's too much for you to read, and then off the back of that, it's, well, what do we do about it? This is going to be a very different beast, so we need to understand what our planning and our priorities look like at the moment, understanding our business, understanding from our leaders, talk to them, give them a questionnaire, do this right from the very, very top, because this is crucial. The way that I've seen things fail and where I've been sent in to turn things around, where there's been flames coming up from everywhere and nobody knows what to do, is because that executive leadership and sponsorship hasn't been there and it's not been followed through. So it's understanding what those priorities are and the executive team actually saying, this is what we need and we're fully behind this. You must give this your absolute attention if you have somebody asking you for input or somebody asking you for something else. For me, what I've done over the many years is there's short versus long term. And short term used to be short, medium and long term as the three areas. We've now got an additional one. So we've got sticking plaster. Every time something changes, we may have to make some minor adjustments. We may have to make some very big adjustments, but we move that short term into extremely short term, which is 1 to 4 weeks. What do we have to do right now, right at this point? We again have issues around, you know, the mental health side of things. I've just worked with a company who have changed the way that they have their mental health provision. They've got the online services, they've got the occupational health scaled up. People will continue to have to work from home and schools are not all going back. The advice that we had was that there's going to be reception year one and year six going back for junior schools, and it will be the children who are doing GCSEs and A-levels. That's brilliant if, you know, you've only got one child in reception, you can actually go back to work. But what if, like me, you have a child in reception and one in year four? You still can't go to work, you're still constrained. So it's understanding as this it gets drip fed, what is the actual impact? And, you know, the fourth strategic layer of all of this, it's really understanding how we layer this one on one in order to get the best from what we're looking for. You know, the short, medium and long term is what you classically have in your strategy. The sticking plaster, I'll show you on the next slide, is how we then make that assessment, how we pull those things in and the levels of inputs that we actually have in order to make that work for you. Because as a company, you've got to do it very, very quickly to understand your current state of play and then to move forward with that. Gunnar took us through last week about the technical solutions. So I have sat on both sides of the fence. I've done both the business and the technical, but what you would need as soon as you have, these are our problems critical to our particular business and our industry and the way that that is impacting us, you would then go out and you would look for, if we don't already have a technical solution in our pipeline that we can pull forward, somebody like Gunnar and his teams would sit down with you and say, we can meet those needs by, they have a playbook. So your assessment is quite key to this. The inputs that would go into it, I've got these on my notebook, so I'm just gonna read them off. So to impact assess, put in your business and IT strategy, your technical roadmap, look at your RAID logs for your risks, assumptions, issues, and dependencies. Look at your IT transformation and support model and the people that you have there to help you. Your IT security, that's pretty critical. What's your policy? How robust is that? And is that needing a massive change? Your financial cash flows and understanding, do we need to go for draft, overdraft? Do we need to go for grants to support us? Cash flow kills businesses. It is the number one killer. That's going to be one of your top priorities to look at. The sales figures, you know, it's very difficult to predict, but take it that if you're in a recession, you're not going to be selling what you did before. Have a look at your sales channels, because obviously if you're online, that's less effective than the retail side. And then you've got the other things like your health and safety requirements. Can you continue to operate as a business to meet those needs? You might have regulatory requirements, which will give you a license to operate. Look at all of these different things. Your innovation agenda. Do you have things that are planned for 3 years hence? I gave Sam an example earlier around this. So there we go. I gave Sam an example around this. And some of that is that there's a company near me called Convatec, and they make medical products. And they have been trying to get something through for 3 years that says we're going to use augmented reality in order to work on our shop floors. Every time that was turned down, it was a nice to have. Now, because they can't get the people on site, they get somebody with the equivalent of Google Glass on, they can actually see and they can have the inputs as we're doing now over Zoom or over Skype for Business. they can see what that person is seeing and they can guide them remotely. The productivity has only dropped for them by a few percent because it's very, very simple to plug those people in as if they're standing there at the right time. So this is an example of moving things forward and getting that to work for you. The last one for me is the innovation agenda. So this is where Gunnar's portfolio will come in. What do we need to do? Can we automate? Can we use 5G? Can we use cloud? Can we use AI? Pardon me, because this might come out wrong, and it's a Japanese name. I think it's Fukuku, and it's an agency that does insurance over in Japan. They have just pivoted in the last week, and they have replaced 32 staff with RPA. Almost their entire interaction on the front end has been taken out with RPA, with bots, with AI solutions, and all those jobs have just gone. And that's not something that they would have done or thought about in a big way. They'd have done it incrementally and a little by little. So that was on their 3 years time plan. They've done that. 32 jobs have just disappeared. And although that's not a nice thing to think about, if it's the difference between your business being able to continue and to make the margins it needs to or not, it's something that the board have to consider. So once we have all of these, Sam, can you go back to this spreadsheet? Slide 6.
So I was just showing the spreadsheet earlier, Tracy. This was what you asked me to put together.
It is, absolutely.
Do you want to talk through this?
Yeah, I mean, this is an example of what you can do. This is something that I've used with clients. It's very, very, very basic, and it's done off the back of a very quick one-hour phone call with the heads of sheds, if you like, or a questionnaire that you put together that's then issued by either the chief exec or the chief operating officer, usually, or the chief financial officer. And it's just around, what's your area within? Is it a people issue? Is it a process issue? Is it a customer or technology issue? What's impacted? Is it likely to impact? When will it impact? It's going to be severe. If it's a mild one, we can deprioritize that if the impact isn't too great. Explain what it is. If we've got some critical people, which was the area I probably should have gone through a little bit on the last slide. If we've got some critical people in the business, you need to understand that if they're not there for any reason, for any length of time, or if they're if they're taken out with COVID, what do we do? Do we have some sort of mitigation? If it's going to be a complete deal breaker and it's somebody in your finance team and you can't process any of your invoices, that's pretty critical. There might not be a director, but those are the people that we need to start to think about. And that was something I did many years ago with Rolls-Royce to make them think it wasn't on the top of their agenda until somebody had a heart attack. And it was devastating for them. That one person was absolutely a critical hire. So all of these things would go on that list. It's then understanding, if we've got these things, do we pull something forward for a sticking plaster? Do we need to do something short-term, medium-term, or long-term? And can we do it now with what we've got, or do we bring other people in? And we stick a priority on it, we take it to the board. It's a very, very clear spreadsheet then as to, this is what we're recommending, this is what we need to do now, these are our priorities. Done very quickly, and at that point then it enables them to make the best decisions that they can with absolutely accurate information from the people that know, because those are the ones that are running that department. So that is, in a nutshell, what I would do with my clients, and it's what I've done over very, very many years. So this is really successful. It's been done to get programs moving, and it's also been done to work with clients in distress, because you very, very quickly, even outside of the COVID world, understand what your problems are and what you need to do to then dovetail in. And at that point, you would bring in somebody technical as a specialist to plug in those technical solutions to that and to get those moving for you.
Thank you for that, Tracy. That was brilliant. We're going to share that spreadsheet with you. As Tracy said, it's, you know, really, really basic format. We've put that together in literally the last 24 hours. So we're going to tidy that up, aren't we, Tracy, and give you some real proper instructions on how to use it. But it's pretty self-explanatory, and we'll share that with all the attendees after the event today. Thank you for that, Tracy. Really appreciate it. Last week, we had Gunnar Menzel from Capgemini talking about TechnoVision. Gunnar, do you want to just give us a bit of a recap on that? Because there's a few people that weren't here last week. We haven't got your slide to hand. I'll try and get it up actually in a second. But do you want to sort of just give us a bit of an overview in that and a recap? Maybe give us some information on, has anything changed from your end in the last week?
Yeah, so I find it fascinating because when you look across Europe, I mean, obviously we in the UK, we focus obviously at the things that we see directly in front of us. But when you look across Europe, yeah, a lot of the different countries do have a different pace and a different position. Give you an example, on Saturday, so next Saturday, if you don't do anything at 2:30 in the afternoon, you're interested in football, it's the first time in 8 weeks that we can watch football again live on television. Now, it's not going to be overly super excited because there won't be any spectators, but it's going to be Borussia Dortmund against Schalke. And if you know those two teams, it's a bit like City against United. So it's the main game in the Bundesliga. The point I was trying to make is, you know, each of the country do have a different pace in terms of their lifting their restrictions. And when I talk to different customers in the different regions, so my role is CTIO, so the Chief Technology Innovation Officer for Capgemini. We have 55,000 staff in Europe, or 60,000 staff, sorry, in Europe at the moment. And when I engage with the various different customers, you do get different types of feedback. So the point that you made just now, there's a slide there, is very relevant, of course, for us in the UK. Now, we're currently starting to think about, you know, June school, how would that work before the summer period? What about our holidays? There's a lot of unknowns, or plenty of unknowns currently. And you see that, of course, the same similar in the different countries as well. All right, you know, they are at different paces, at different positions. I think one thing that we do see a lot, and again, Tracy mentioned this, this point around agility, we do see a lot of companies shifting very quickly, responding to the new demand that they're getting, shifting their business model very quickly. One day a company may be supplying food for hospitals. The second day they are in the midst of being the main supplier from PPE perspective because they have good logistical connections. We heard that last week. So agility seems to be kind of a business. Agility seems to be kind of a key trend as well, being able to really quickly respond to the demand. And with that, and this is also learning from a lot of customer interactions, is actually understanding what do customers need. Now, before, if you were in the retail sector or in manufacturing or in distribution or in logistics, particularly logistics, you know, the business model was very clear for many, many years. Now, still with COVID-19, it has changed slightly. And you see more and more customers, organizations being even more customer-centric. So really kind of responding very quickly to different customer demand and situations. Just look at companies like DBT or Royal Mail, the way they now have to deliver parcels in front of your door. They need to be wary or need to be aware of people being in lockdown or being in safe isolation. What about signatures? You know, if you get a post, I mean, if your doorbell rings 7 minutes and somebody delivers something to you, you have just open the door and then leave it in front of your door and take a picture. Whereas before, had to be following a certain process for signing and getting the signature. So agility from a business perspective is clearly something that is really important. And we see today, there's a short-term focus, sticky plaster you mentioned, is really focusing on that. So focusing on obviously connectivity, focusing on the technology side, and that's kind of the thing that we mentioned last week, but also kind of seeing it as an opportunity. It's not, you know, COVID-19, obviously, it's impacts all of us, impacts the business, but it does create new opportunities as well. And many companies are starting, particularly, again, if you look a bit wider than just the UK, particularly in other countries, are starting to think about, okay, what will happen now in end of May or in June or in July? How do I deliver my goods, my services? How do I engage with my customers, my end users? Even in this situation, I don't know whether you've seen the note also, the working environment is changing. Twitter announced, I think yesterday, that they working from home is not a temporary measure. They're saying that you can stay at home. There's no need to come to the office because they think they can still operate in the same way as it did before, with the changing environment, of course, changing behavior. People are changing the ways they're working. Things like this is pretty normal now to all of us. You know, whereas before, I look back when I was involved in, or I'm involved in RFIs and RFPs, so requests for proposals, oral presentations always had to be face-to-face. Now it's pretty obvious. You know, people expect it has to be over video. And a lot of our customers are telling us that they consider that to be the new norm. So, you know, there's more and more working from home and more working remotely. Last week, and if you go quickly on this next slide, I mentioned, obviously, there's in Capgemini, we do a lot of market research. And the feedback also and the suggestion also to all of you is, you know, read and learn and see what others are doing. Most notably, of course, other regions. If you stay on the other one just quickly. I'm finished in a minute. But something I think that's really important as well is, you know, when you look at your situation, Tracy went through her slide, her Excel spreadsheet, you know, you're lifting up where you are today and how you respond, listen and learn from others. So something I think that is really important is to look at other regions, look at China, South Korea, Singapore. They were affected in January, February, and March, slightly behind us, or we're behind them. So, you know, learn from them, see if it's in your sector, how they succeeded, if they have, and if they haven't, what were the kind of key mistakes they made so you don't make them. And pick up research material. You know, Capgemini, obviously, we have a research institute where we issue external material, which is free, available, so you can download the material and consume it. Others, of course, do the same thing. So that's something I think that's quite important. Now, if you go quickly onto the last slide. Again, Tracy mentioned technology a couple of times before. We have, and Sam mentioned this, we have a framework called Technovision. Technovision is basically a collection of the key trends that we see fueling the digital transformation. Technovision has been written for the last 12 years, so it's this 12th year of the issue. And Technovision articulates all the technologies that are relevant to customers when they are progressing on a digital transformation. So everything around infrastructure, everything around applications, integration, data, and user and collaboration. And we have 37 trends that we track and we identified as being the key trends from a technology perspective. And we'll, here in the slide, I picked out the key ones that we feel are most relevant to organizations globally when they're dealing with a pandemic like COVID-19. And there are three that are most relevant that we think are kind of a catalyst, but also an enabler. So cloud is one. Cloud, usually out of necessity from a cost-saving perspective, but also around this agility point that I made before. Tracy also mentioned RPA, chatbots, other tools, quickly deployable. So cloud clearly is kind of a play or can be a platform that drives agility and flexibility because it enables you to start services, infrastructure service very quickly without you having to procure, install, configure service, infrastructure services. Second one is AI, artificial intelligence. There are a number of really insightful and really good examples where AI across the entire spectrum from COVID-19. So what I mean in terms of prevent, contain, and suppress, where AI can, or is helping significantly. And the last point is around automation around clearly automating activities that are currently manual or semi-manual because people may be not able to execute them because they're physically not there or because you maybe want to kind of get your staff to focus on other things. One point we're making also is we don't really see or we haven't seen so far jobs being lost purely because of automation. We see automation being an enabler. And actually the people that are not having to execute those manual interventions, they actually been deployed elsewhere to help in other areas, maybe to drive innovation or to be redeployed to work in other areas. And I'm talking here, of course, automation in a process technology perspective, not automation just from a business perspective. So what are kind of the the things that, that were mentioned last time, like I said, the kind of key plea or suggestions that I made was, you know, look elsewhere, have a look across the sectors, not just in the UK, but elsewhere. Learn from others, use research material that may help you to come to your own plan. As Tracy's mentioned, you know, the sticky plaster, the identification of the things that you need to do today, tomorrow, not in 4 weeks' time or in 3 months' time.
That's great, Gunnar. Thank you very much indeed for that. Really appreciate you taking the time out for us again today. I'm going to put it out to the floor now and give people a chance to maybe ask some questions. I think we've got about we've got plenty of time, and I think on the cloud subject of cloud, Atul, we've got you on the call today, haven't we? Atul's currently contracting for Microsoft at the moment, so I think you've got quite a bit of experience on this, Atul. Do you want to, any questions for Gunnar, for Tracy, anything that you'd like to add?
Yeah, I think there are some insights I can share. So, I mean, just as you mentioned, I've actually been with Microsoft since autumn last year, and it was strangely just before the COVID-19 pandemic started, we were actually looking at ways that we could use the Office 365 product set in a more dynamic way for 22 vertical sectors around the world. So it was healthcare, it was petrochemical, it was retail, really seeing how we could get better traction of the product suite. So it was a strange kind of maybe a fortunate series of events that happened for Microsoft, was that we were actually throughout the months over Christmas and the early new year, we're already looking to see how the product suite can help vertical sectors improve their KPIs. So for example, if it's to do with, I don't know, if it's retail, trying to improve, I don't know, online shopping, or try to better improve in those days footfall, okay, to how the healthcare sector can improve, I don't know, medical loss ratios or things like that. We're really looking at how each of those particular Microsoft products can help deliver on that. So what's happened is that it was actually only in March this year that we actually provided a complete product suite, a complete recommendation of how for each of the particular KPIs for a number of the verticals, which products can help the enterprise deliver on those KPIs. So what's happened since then is that having COVID-19 as a spin on things and accelerating a lot of the drive for digital transformation that we were seeing using the Microsoft product suite, it's created this much bigger drive to actually get those things done. So in today's world, Microsoft, for example, are actually, by some suite of events, are very well prepared in their sales teams to actually understand not only how teams can work in a more generic way, but also about how remote collaboration or how using the other product suites can help deliver on more specific KPIs of the various enterprises. So what we were looking at was, on average, it must have been about 40 or so KPIs for 22 verticals. So that's a lot of KPIs. That's over 400 KPIs that we managed to align to how the Microsoft product suite can help deliver. So having that capability set already defined, and now in this post-COVID-19 world where we see things accelerating, the great use of not only of people working from home, but the great use of people using telemedicine to a whole bunch of other areas for all types of verticals, it's really put companies like Microsoft in a very good position right now. So there's very much the heat is on now to try and make those things become more real and become more specific. So today we're talking about how we can use Teams for doing Teams calls or things like that. What we're looking at in the future is how we can use specific Microsoft products to really help senior managers deliver on KPIs if it's to do with improved sustainability or improve employee retention or basically improve on the financials as well. So we do see, you know, I think for example, for Microsoft, we did have a plan already for the next 5 years. And really what's happened is that things have just literally gone on, on a much faster accelerated rate on that. So there are already some great insights there, and just hearing the conversation now, what your delegates are talking about, you know, where it's already much, it just brings a much greater sense of urgency to everything we're doing. So for us right now, we're basically, it's very much at senior level in the US about how we now provide these recommendations, but they are acting, they are moving with a great sense of urgency. So although we see things, you know, in a bit sense of chaos, in a very reactionary world right now, I think hopefully by the end of the year near the end of the year, there will be a much more consistent story for particular verticals about how to respond and how to make the best use of all these digital products that are out there, especially for the Microsoft suite. So that's just my
interesting
conversation, Sam. Sorry, I was a bit short notice into all of this. So
listen, I appreciate your time, Atul, and I really appreciate your comment there. I know you're contracting for Microsoft. Are you on any sort of bonus or commission right now?
I'm just a freelance contractor, and as you know, I was just quite fortunate to be in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
And the great thing was, instead of I work in Microsoft US, not even in the UK, so they've really just gone directly to me, which is quite nice. I feel quite chuffed by that. But putting all the issues to aside with COVID-19 in the industry, you know, clearly in the sector space, entities like Microsoft, Google and Amazon are really on a hyperdrive at the moment to try and deliver things. And
I guess that's got to be the case for lots of other businesses and companies that are developing products or redeveloping products and launching products. That's everybody seems to be on that hyper growth mode now. It's interesting actually, because I did speak to an IT director. I'm sure it wasn't the IT director, but it was one senior director for Microsoft who was based in New York, but he was working out of Washington. And he was telling me a very, very similar thing to what you've just said there. He's working on products now that are going to be industry changing. And he couldn't go into the detail. And I couldn't speculate on what it was, but I can imagine. And what's actually interesting there is going back to what Tracy was saying about sticking plasters. It's a bit like the last 4 to 6 weeks, it's been, right, sticking plasters, Zoom, Microsoft Teams. I was talking to an IT director for a big insurance company. He's been trying to get the business to take on Teams for the last 12, 18 months. And they've been, no. All of a sudden, it's done in 2 weeks. But actually, what Tracy was talking about there was this proper actual software in collaboration around, was it Google Glass or Tracy?
It's called HoloLens, but it works in a similar way to Google Glass. It's augmented reality.
So that's really taking Zoom and collaboration and Teams to another level, where people can properly work on things in a real three-dimensional world, but do it remotely. And
I think what's happening is that if you look at technology and how now it's really been thrust onto executives, I think people are still in this, playing get to know you mode of the technology. So as I think you mentioned, I think Tracy mentioned about Teams, you know, people had Teams, the enterprises bought the Teams license and they were essentially buying the whole suite of products there, but, you know, didn't really have the mechanism to really drive those through the organization. So what's happening now, people are playing with gadgetry in a completely different way to see how it can work for them. I think over time things will mature. It's like, I hear about virtual coffee chats that, my wife works as a senior person in BT and having these virtual coffee chats, and they have and the way though that technology is now replacing that office environment is we're still going through a learning curve right now. You know, it's interesting, you know, the conversation that you could have by the water cooler, as they would say, in the office still needs to happen. The way that that some countries and some territories have a really, you know, get things done through people being in a room, or as in France, if I remember, having that conversation over lunch, that type of environment in today's world, you know, I think are the opportunities that still need to be addressed, and it's quite exciting to see how these things mature. So it's great to hear about augmented reality and all these great technology things. But, you know, I think really it's a great time. People are now playing with these things.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, even for myself, I never used Zoom until the COVID-19 crisis. You know, I was only really using Teams in a more religious way since autumn last year, when I was working a lot with Microsoft to really understand their product suite. Despite the fact I used to be the head of innovation and architecture for one of the biggest water companies in the UK, where we had people working remotely, and we bought the Microsoft package, but we just couldn't get people to use it. And we had these crazy digital evangelists in my team. They were digital architects who were waving the flag for all these things, but people just thought they were just the crazy guys in the corner, you know.
Yeah.
Suddenly, it's great how things have been thrust.
I was going to say, I think it is a lot about actually training and development and getting people engaged with these technologies. I really appreciate that, Atul. Thank you for that. I want to bring in Susie. So Susie is currently working, or has just recently finished working, for a very large retailer. Susie, I know you can't talk too much about what you've been doing specifically. I'm going to try and just unmute you, Susie, if I can. But do you want to just share with us a little bit of you know, your experience and what you've seen sort of change from a retail perspective? Would that be okay?
Yeah, sure. That's no problem at all. I can be open about where I just left, which is pets at home. And quite a lot of what's been spoken about here really resonates in terms of the pivot that we had to make as an organisation at the point at which this hit. So we'd only got very basic video conferencing in play at the time at which COVID-19 hit. And we actually chose Google Hangouts and implemented it within a week. And we were already in a selection exercise at that time around Office 365 and Google. But it was at that point that Google stepped up to the plate to offer things free before Microsoft did, which was the pivot moment for us. And implementing that very quickly was a huge step change and enabled us to get everyone out of the support office again within a week period. Our VPN was absolutely fine. All of the office was okay. But we'd previously just been using telephones and teleconferencing. And the real difference for us was around that ability to see one another and have the meetings with everyone in play. And I guess one of the things that I was going to raise today, which is actually a non-technical part, is about the welfare of colleagues now that you are all working from home and the video conferencing side of things. So what we started to see at Pets at Home was a lot of people working longer hours as soon as they started working at home and being on the video tech. A lot of colleagues not having the right, let's say, office environment at home. So although we had been very fortunate and a lot of people had been on laptops already, so they were able to work, people don't have the same physical setup that they do in an office. So I don't know whether anyone's got any experience of whether that's affecting colleagues physically in any way. We can't guarantee that colleagues who had had an adjusted chair in the office had got one in their home, what their seating conditions were like. We've seen colleagues who are working on windowsills because their partner is working on the kitchen table. So that whole piece around how the, if this is going to continue in the way that perhaps the, you know, the move by Twitter to say everyone's going to work from home, how we're going to deal with that welfare. So not even the mental welfare, but the physical welfare of colleagues in this scenario. And the other part that, again, this is a perhaps a non-technical piece, but I think there is going to be a fundamental technical part coming underpinning this, is starting to potentially see colleagues being slightly disadvantaged by their home technical setup. So where they don't have as good broadband and they're not able to participate as much in the video conference and what they miss out on as a result. So I'm sure you'll all have experienced when you've been using teleconferencing yourself, it's a lot more intense. You can't actually see the way that people are reacting. If you've got colleagues who are working in a video conferencing way and can see that reaction, are a lot more engaged in the physical session themselves. And so that part around how are we going to make sure that we get, technical equivalence and that we don't end up disadvantaging colleagues who don't have perhaps exactly the same tech setup. Now, that was purely from the support office perspective. What we saw from a retail store's perspective, though, mirrored that in a number of ways. So we found that we had colleagues who were being more disadvantaged by the area in which they were, and then the physical exposure that they were having in their stores. So I think the whole virus is driving a lot more obvious divisions in kind of haves and have nots across the UK, and I'm kind of interested in other people's views on that and whether they're seeing that mirrored in their organizations.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I'm going to bring in Jimmy. Jimmy, do you want to introduce yourself? We know each other already, don't we, mate? How are you?
I'm good, mate. How are you?
Yeah, I'm all right, thank you. Good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you too. So I'm Jimmy Hosang, everybody. I'm the CEO of the Modular Analytics Company, who are a company who specializes in decisioning using data. Bit of a slogan is better decisions faster. And we do that in a couple of different ways for a couple of different use cases. So one is around next best action for customers. So identifying customer need and then servicing that need through products and propositions that our clients provide. One is around next best action for people. So identifying like a learning need or a development need within an employee base, and then matching that against like knowledge management or coaching conversations, and then pushing that to them. And then we've got a bit around transactional kind of maybe you'd probably call it like risk analysis. So we use speech transcription to score calls up using machine learning around like the risk of the call for compliance fails or fraud, or the likelihood that the customer will repeat on a future transaction. But that's the boring bit. What I just wanted to jump into what Susie was talking about. So about people. So I've noticed with my guys, and it's probably a question to like the group, is how are you finding like your developers are coping from working at home, especially those with like young families? We've only got a small team of five developers, you know, a couple of data scientists and three developers. But they all have children that are under two who are not currently in nursery. And I can honestly say that it's taking like a real toll on them, because, you know, let's be honest, like me and my guys, we're all a bit up on the spectrum. We're used to like getting focused and like causing and like working on like specific tasks. And it's the constant interruption and the constant background of what's going on within the home. It's actually having like a real like impact just on their well-being. And I just was interested in like opening that up to the group about like, are you guys seeing the same things, or like, how are you kind of managing that kind of stuff?
Yeah. Tim, do you want to jump in there?
I'll unmute myself. Yeah, we started off really worrying about whether we were going to get efficiency out of people. You know, it's all very well driving and managing people from the office, but from a home situation, it's obviously a lot more difficult. And I think we've kind of phased away from that a little bit and started worrying more about, we're accepting that people aren't going to be as efficient as they were. And so it now becomes more to do with well-being. And, you know, because if people are completely burnt out, they're going to have, you know, pretty much 0% efficiency. So, and it's a difficult one to approach because you can't really use one method across your whole company. We're just an SME as well, 25 people, furloughed probably half of them. But the people we class as key, they're all different personalities and they've all got different ways of working. So you can't necessarily be lax across the whole board. So it makes it very difficult. And there's a few people that I'd very happily not speak to for a week and know that they're going to be working into the late hours to catch up if they need to. And you know, other people that if you don't get on their backs, that they might take the piss a little bit, you know. So that's the biggest challenge for us at the moment. Yeah. So.
Yeah. Thank you, Tim. Paul, would you like to join in? Give me your thoughts there.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, I'm someone who's worked from home for, I don't know, 20 odd years in different guises. And when we had little kids, one of the things I did was I very much spread my, I don't know, nominal 8 hours across quite a large period of the day. So, you know, I would tend to start really quite early, probably before the kids were up, and get an hour and a half in there or something like that. When the kids could go to school, I would then take them to school. I might come home, do another hour and a bit, go to the gym, come back, do another couple of hours. So over the day, I did my 8 hours. And having that flexibility as an employer to recognise that not everybody necessarily wants to come and turn their computer on at 9 and turn it off at 5 and feel like they're being to work, I think being flexible about that, allowing people to chip in, allowing them to go and recharge the batteries somewhat. You know, I've got a Gunnar and I, a good friend of mine, who Martin Crawford, who works at Capgemini, what he does is each day he blocks out an hour and he goes for a bike ride for an hour and comes back and then carries on. You know, as an employer, if you're flexible to that, I realise that doesn't work for everybody, but if you're flexible to that and can accept it. And the other thing is to go and talk to each of your employees, you know, to take Tim's point, if you know what each person's style is, if you know what works for them, then as an employer, you kind of got to take some responsibility for finding out what that is and actually talking to them in the way that they need to be talked to and the way that they need to be engaged. Quite happily, some people, as you say, can be left for days on end and you know they're being productive. Other people find it more difficult when they've suddenly finished a task to then go, what should I do next? And helping people through that. So having regular check-in points, even if it's just for 10 minutes, can really help a lot of people. That's all I wanted to chip in. But to go back to some of Gunnar's points, though, I've seen three things technologically. I've seen a lot of focus on networks. I'm working with a couple of the large police forces in the UK, and the networking people, their suppliers, BT and Vodafone and people like that, have tried to step up the game quite considerably. So we've seen a lot of quite good innovation around networks to support home working. The police are not normally a fan of home working, but it's remarkable how much they've done over the last 4 or 5 weeks. And at all, the other thing they've done is they've managed to accelerate an MS Teams implementation project that's been trundling along for about 18 months, 2 years, and all of a sudden it's in and it's working and everyone loves it. And actually, I saw a survey the other day, 74% of people would rather do all their work through Teams now. It's quite remarkable overnight. So networks and supporting things like that is important. RPA, I think, Susie, you mentioned about RPA. I think there's an interesting one about automating processes to release people, especially those tasks that are better to automate than to try to do with a virtually dispersed team. So I think focusing on the right processes to automate is really interesting and actually can actually improve your capability. And then the final thing, you know, it's an old bugbear of mine, but testing, you know, automating some testing, getting the testing done the danger is that we react to these tactical responses by doing things quickly without really assuring the solution that we've put in. We might not be able to do it before we put it in, but we somehow need to put some sort of quality assurance and some industrialization behind that to back it up. The danger is we go back to the old days where we have lots and lots of little point solutions that never quite integrate when we all come back to work in 6 months' time. So there was just those three observations around the technical side that I thought I'd throw in as well.
Thank you for that, Paul. Really appreciate it. Would anybody else like to ask a question to Tracy or to Gunnar before we start to wind down the event?
Can I ask
Jimmy, go.
So a big one for me is, and it's a bit of a bugbear of mine, is that a lot of people tend to focus and concentrate on digitization. So digitizing channels, pushing people to web and apps and things. And a lot of people have been pushing to web chat. I think it's more of it's an open question, but where I've seen like a lot of opportunity and also a lot of risk is now a lot of voice being done at home. So you've got like big contact centers who've had like 500 to 2,000 people who have now moved from, an office-based system where there was great spans of control, there was info security like wrapped around, there was people watching you, to now working at home. And I'd be interested to see if you've got many of the guys on this call, Tracy, Gunnar, but have you guys been looking at like what is actually happening there now that people are answering customers' calls and things like within the confines of their own home without the controls that have usually been in place?
Well, I'll answer that one. So virtual call centres have been around for quite some time, but people just usually don't go for that solution. They do like to have people office-based. They like to be able to see them, see the whites of their eyes, listening to the calls. Absolutely. I've done it. I at university, I worked for a company in Yorkshire to pay my way. So I've done it. Inbound, outbound, I understand the control mechanisms and I absolutely get where you're coming from, because you want those calls to stay at the same level of service that you'd expect in order to give that reputational that reputational enhancement to your business. Those contact centers are absolutely critical to, your survival going forward. But there are other solutions out there where you can work in a dispersed way. And you still have those controls. You still have the way that you can put that headset on and listen to that call, that you can get those metrics. They don't have to be co-located in order to do it. So if that's something that you can't do, it might be something that if you want to keep this model going forward, you look at a different solution eventually and look to moving to that in order to maintain it, because it does have its advantages. Yes, there are problems with small children running around at home at the moment, and I'm one of them. I've got a four-year-old and he's driving me nuts. I'd like to kill him most of the time. I've had to bribe him to be on the Xbox so I can do this call for an hour. So I know what it's like with your developers. Absolutely get it. But that software, if you want to look at your costs and the way that you can move forward, potentially not having that office, you would need to then look at the benefits of moving to another solution that would give you the control that you want. They are out there.
Yes, for that, Tracy.
One of the things, just picking up on that, that we did at Pets at Home was we moved a lot of the customer communication away from the phones and onto email. And that was partly because our ability to move the voice around wasn't great. But the other thing was it gave us the ability to almost split out according to the contact center person's ability into what they could and couldn't answer, which just gave us not so much control, but making that feeling that the customer was getting the best possible service that we could give at that time. And we don't take any payments, so that was okay for us because it meant that we weren't actually dealing with any PCI compliance issues as a result. But actually just thinking about the contact center in a different way, and making sure that the really experienced agents were the only ones who were left with any telephony, worked well for us.
I think that might be a way that it goes as well, where we're working with some companies and we've built some predictive models based on Q1 this year, based on quality. So, quality compliance, FCA regulation, like how likely were people to have failed these things. and we're now deploying them like in a home-based situation and looking at how like quality may have deteriorated. And it might be the case where like some of these companies are starting to look at their footprint and go, well, we can half our actual footprint, so long, because half of the guys need to be on site and half of the guys have really great quality coming working from home as well. So I think that might be an interesting thing.
Yeah. And I think you might find that some of the guys want to be on site.
Yeah.
So I think you're going to have to bring that dynamic in, that we're going to have to look at, there's going to be people who want to work from home, there's people who can work from home, and there's going to be people who do want to be away from home. So we've got some colleagues with younger children. We've also got some colleagues who have been isolating with elderly relatives as well. And those guys are finding it just as hard. And when we were saying, right, everyone out of the office, we were having people come to us and just say, I really would like to be in the office. Is there a way I can be in? And I think we're going to have that dynamic going forward as well, that people, some people just won't ever really have a suitable home environment, perhaps. And there won't be ways that we can help them, that actually the office environment is the best way for them to do that. So maybe some people who are in house shares, or people who are kind of, you know, shielding with other people.
Thank you for that, Susie. I'm gonna sum up now. So I really do thank everybody for attending today. It's been great to hear again from Gunnar and also from Tracy. Thank you everyone for attending. Thank you, Susie. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Atul. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Jimmy. It's been really, really good. I think that the few things that have to pick up on from a summary point of view, Microsoft are obviously smashing it. Thanks, Atul, for that. I do hope you get your commission, by the way, on that one. But also, you know, we're talking about Google and Amazon. They're not just now looking at how do we put those sticking plasters on, but they, I think, are now looking at how can they shape short-term, medium-term, and long-term growth around their products. And interestingly, I think that those products are going to grow and grow and grow. And you know, Tracy talking about augmented reality, I think we're just kind of seeing a new way of working. It was interesting, actually. There's a guy who's based in the Northwest that does a lot of these events. He's called Chris Maguire, and he works for a company called Business Cloud. He's a brilliant speaker, and I'd love to get him on to actually chair one of these events because he's quite funny. But he was talking on LinkedIn this morning that he sees two different types of people for all the events he's done on COVID, people that are kind of in a bit of a panic, and they're not sure how they're going to cope, and they're really still searching for answers. And people that are in a different camp, they're just kind of like, listen, this is it. This is the new normal. We've just got to crack on. We've not changed anything. In fact, we've pivoted. And we're just getting on with stuff. And it's kind of business as usual. So it's quite interesting to hear which camp you're in, really, whether it's that still almost panic mode of, crikey, we still don't know what's going to happen, or whether it's just kind of business as usual, pivot and change and move forward. So, you know, leave you with that thought. Thank you all for joining. And if anybody wants to talk to me offline about, you know, key pivotal hires, how can we help either you find your next role or perhaps help you with a critical hire within your business, I'm here to talk at any time. Thank you, Tracy. Thank you again, Gunnar, for joining us today. And thank you all for attending. We'll send out a feedback form. I'm going to share the full video of this if you want to see it, and also the slides that you've seen today. And let's stay in touch, and thank you again.
Thanks, Sam. Thanks, everyone.
All right.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Sam.
Thanks
Cheers.
A lot. Cheers.
Cheers, guys.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Hey, Sam.
Hi, Tracy.
Well, that...